Hi, everybody. Welcome to Queens Public Library's Science Everywhere. I'm Lynn. And a little bit about the library before we get started with our program. Queens Public Library continues to celebrate our 125th anniversary. Don't forget to browse for books, share your Queens Public Library story, or take our library personality quiz. For more information, visit QPL125.org. For this year's celebration of Black History Month, Queens Public Library is focusing on Black health and wellness from a holistic lens. Join our virtual programs, check out our Black History book recommendations, and get a copy of our health journal to track your progress throughout the month of February. Learn more at queenslib.org/BHM2022. And oh, happy Lunar New Year, everyone. This is the year of the tiger. Celebrate with our virtual programs and book recommendations. Learn more at queenslib.org/librarylovers2022. And welcome to Science Everywhere at our regular time, 4 p.m. here on YouTube Live. Science Everywhere is a program of the Hunters Point Environmental Education Center made possible by the Newtown Creek Environmental Benefit Fund, administered by the City Parks Foundation and funded by the New York State Department of Environmental Conservation. And it has really been cold out, hasn't it? What have you been doing to stay warm? You know, most of us are, I hope, have a nice warm apartment or house and warm clothes to wear and yummy food to eat. I really like soups and chili in the wintertime. But have you noticed that some of our animal neighbors are around in the wintertime and they're outside? We're going to be talking about how they stay safe and warm in the wintertime. And so let's say hi to Miss Mary.
Hi, Mary. Hi, Lynn. Hi, Lynn. Hi, everybody. So yes, I have been staying inside a lot. And when I go outside, I've been wearing lots of warm clothes and I've been eating lots of warm food and drinking hot cocoa. So I'm interested to hear how animals manage to survive winter without all those things that us humans have. And we're going to help, we humans are going to help the animals out a little bit this week. Because we're going to be giving them a little food treat. We're going to be making these bird seed cookies. Well, seeds, as Miss Lynn will tell you, are perfect foods for birds. They have lots and lots of energy. And so they're great for birds when they're looking for food. And food is not as easy to come by in the winter here in New York City. So we're going to be making these cookies as our activity at the end of the program. And if you want to get your materials ready, what you're going to need is a cup of birdseed, an envelope of plain gelatin. Now, this is not Jell-O. It's not that sweetened colored kind. It's just the plain gelatin. Knox gelatin is the kind that you might be familiar with. You also need a quarter cup of boiling water, and you're going to need a grown-up to help you out with that. I have my quarter cup of boiling water here, and it's pretty hot, so I have something around it to keep myself safe. Then you're going to need something to make your mold your cookie with. I have a cup. You could use a cookie cutter, the lid of a jar, anything that's going to give your cookie, your birdseed cookie, some shape. And let's see, what else? You need some string or twine, something to hang your cookie up outside when it's finished so that the birds can get it. Good news, Queens Public Library at Hunters Point has a grab-and-go kit that has all the materials that I just described to you in the kit. So you can pick it up at Hunters Point Library, and the address is right there. That's going to be there. We set them out today. They're going to be there for a couple more days while supplies last, as they say. So you can watch this program now and then swing by the library, pick up the kit, and make the birdseed cookie whenever you're ready. So, Lynn, let's talk about animals and in New York City. Do all of the animals that live in New York City stay here all year round?
Oh, no. There are some of them that just don't want to be here in the wintertime because they can't find the food that they need. They can't stay warm. So mostly birds and in particular, the famous monarch butterfly leave for the wintertime and go south. And it's mostly birds that fly south. And then there are some birds that live during the summer further north and fly to New York for the summer, I mean, for the winter time. And so that's called migration. And lots of animals migrate, but we have an awful lot of animals that stick around all year round. Don't you have a book about that, Miss Mary?
I do. I have this great book. It's a really cute book called When It Starts to Snow. And the author is Phyllis Gershner. And the publisher is Henry Holt and Company. And it's a book about what animals do in the winter when it starts to snow. What if it starts to snow? What do you do? Where do you go? I creep into the house, says the mouse. Cold winds blow when it starts to snow. I sit by the window, says the cat. Big eyes glow when it starts to snow. I keep watch, says the shiny crow. Caw, caw, caw when it starts to snow. I look for seeds, says the sparrow. Peck, peck, peck when it starts to snow. What if it starts to snow? What do? Where do you go? We fly south, say the geese, all in a row. Honk, honk, honk when it starts to snow. I build a lodge, says the beaver. The work is slow. Chop, chop, chop when it starts to snow. The water is chilly, says the fish. It's best to lie low. Swish, shh, shh. When it starts to snow. What if it starts to snow? What do? Where do you go? I wear a new coat, says the stoat. A king from head to toe, white winter fur when it starts to snow. I follow the turtle, says the frog. Down into the mud I go. Peep, peep, peep when it starts to snow. I look for a place, says the deer, where the moss and grasses grow. Leap, leap, run when it starts to snow. I dive down the hill, says the otter. I go with the flow. Slip, slide, slip when it starts to snow. Look, says the black bear, the snow is deep. Hurry, scurry, time to sleep. We have this page that has all the animal tracks and our friend back here watching. Bat in a cave, snake in a rock pile, raccoon in a log, squirrel in a hollow, mole in a tunnel, rabbit in a hole, wolf in a den, chipmunk in a burrow. And this page here has all those animals in all places. The bat is back here, and the snake is here, and the rabbit's in a hole over here, all the different places. Snow on the roof, snow on the ground, brand new snow coming down, coming down. I can't sleep when the snow wants to play. Three cheers for snow, hip hip, hooray. And that is the end. We always clap for a good book. So I really like that book, though, even though it's a pretty simple book and it's it doesn't have a lot of science in it. In a way, if you look carefully, there is a fair amount of science in it. Lynn, are some of those animals in the book here in New York during the winter?
Well, you know, really about all, almost all of those animals are in New York State for sure. Not all of them here in the city, but a lot of those animals are in the city. And so our friends out there, think about the animals that you've seen outside that you've noticed maybe out your window or when you're in a on a walk, and you can type those into the chat or just call them out at home. And by the way, if you have any questions or comments, we would love to hear from you. You can put that in the chat. And so some of the animals that it named in the book were squirrels, and I bet all of us have seen squirrels, and maybe not mice so much. I hope nobody has mice in their house getting warm. I certainly do see rats around and rabbits. I think, Miss Mary, you said you have rabbits in your yard.
I have rabbits in our yard. I have a very small yard, but we do have some bunnies that live. And I think even in the, I've seen bunny tracks in the snow.
Oh. And raccoons, which I have seen right in some of the busiest parts of the city. It's kind of remarkable. And of course, birds. And one of the animals it named in the book was a stoat. And a stoat is a common name for a weasel. And we do have weasels in New York State. And who knows, there might be weasels. I suspect there's some kinds of weasels here in the city. Otter are a type of weasel. And I think there are some otters that live around the maybe the Bronx River and maybe even in some of our parks that have lakes. And so all of those animals that do stick around all winter long, they have to have a place to, a way to stay warm, a way to stay safe, and food to eat. And we have some pictures to share with you of some of our animal neighbors that spend the whole year with us. So I'm going to share my screen. There we go. Can you see that?
Yes.
Oh, but you know what? I need to go to the very beginning. Uh-oh.
There you go.
That was good. So who can find the animal in this picture? This animal is in a nice shelter that it's found. It looks pretty cozy for an animal that has to find its own place out of the wind and rain and snow in the winter time. You see that face there in the dark? This is a black bear. And I don't think you'd find a black bear here in the city, but there's certainly black bears in outside of the city where there's more woods. And so black bears are one of those animals that are kind of famous for taking a long winter nap or hibernating. And animals that hibernate, they have to build up fat at the end of the summer. All the animals need to build up fat at the end of the summer, whether they're going to migrate or they're going to stay around for the winter time. So they eat lots of food. And then when they are doing their special kind of sleeping or hibernating, their body slows down. Everything it does, their breathing slows down. They don't eat or drink anything. They can go for 3 months without eating or drinking, although they sometimes wake up when it warms up a bit and maybe go out and have a little snack. And their heart rate, which would normally be 40 to 50 heartbeats a minute, that's a little bit slower than ours, it slows down to only 8 heartbeats a minute. And here are some other animals that some people don't like, but I think are awfully cool. They're really important to our environment. These are bats. They're little tiny animals about the size of mice. And you can see they're clustered together to help them stay warm. They're in a cave. And they also slow their body processes down to conserve their energy through the winter time. They are insect eaters, and of course they're not going to find hardly any insects around in the winter time. Oh, here's a famous hibernator.
I want to talk about this one, Lynn. So I think if everyone thought about what tomorrow is, you might guess what this guy is. Tomorrow is February 2nd, which is Groundhog Day. And this guy is a, or gal, I don't know, is a groundhog. Groundhogs are another animal that are sort of famous for hibernating, although groundhogs are sort of more famous for waking up than sleeping. But groundhogs do hibernate like bears. They hibernate for 3 months, so November, December, and January, and they tend to wake up in February. So sometime along in our history, a tradition came developed where people thought if a groundhog woke up from his hibernation and saw his shadow, then there would be 6 more weeks of winter. So winter would be 6 weeks longer. And then if he didn't see his shadow, then spring would be right around the corner. Spring would be happen in fewer than 6 weeks. So that's sort of a fun tradition, but scientists have actually been sort of keeping track of this for a while, because this has been a tradition that's been around for quite a while. And scientists have found that, in fact, the groundhog is only right about half of the time. And so it's sort of just like flipping a coin, heads or tails. So sometimes the groundhog is right and sometimes the groundhog is wrong, but it's still a really fun tradition, something to do on a cold February day. So tomorrow we all will be checking to see if the groundhog has gotten woken up from his hibernation and whether or not he has seen his shadow. And if tradition tells us that if he does see a shadow, we're in for 6 more weeks of winter. If not, spring is just around the corner. So we'll see if the groundhog is right this year. And that's just a fun hibernating tradition.
Wow, look at those big teeth that groundhog has. He's a rodent, like rats and mice, and one of the other animals we're going to be looking at. A beaver. And that's one of the animals that was in the book where, do you remember, it said that they build a lodge? And you look, this beaver is hard at it there. They use their great big front teeth or incisors to, they can literally chop down trees. And if you look, you can see this is a part of this limb that beaver has chopped down with its teeth. And they also eat twigs and bark and other tough plant materials. And they mound up all that in the edge of water. And it makes a very cozy den for them. And they'll even store some food in the wintertime down in their den. And I think Miss Mary has something very special to show us about beaver in just a few minutes. Ooh, would you think about frog during the winter time? You're sure not going to see those out and about. But our frogs and toads and lizards and snakes and turtles, they don't migrate. They bury themselves in mud or down under leaves, maybe down under a rotten log while they'll be well protected from the cold. And they are cold-blooded animals, which doesn't mean they're mean. It just means that their body temperature stays the same as what their surroundings are. And their body processes also slow down so that they don't need food or water or a lot of oxygen when it's cold. Now, here's a surprising thing. This is a woolly bear caterpillar, and you can see it is very woolly and sort of bear-like looking, I guess. They overwinter as caterpillars in plant material where they're kind of protected from the very cold weather. And also, so there are some insects that overwinter, like oh my gosh, I'm blank. Bees. Can't think of the kind of bees. But they have kind of an antifreeze in their blood so that they can stay alive and all their body processes slow down so that in the springtime they can come out and be active again. Oh, and there is an Eastern cottontail. Those are the kind of bunnies that Miss Mary has in her yard.
I think so. And
they don't dig burrows or tunnels like it shows sometimes in books. Our North American rabbits hide like in the brush, like up under bushes and where there's a lot of grasses and weeds and leaves, and they kind of hunker down, maybe dig sort of a depression where they can stay warm. And they do have to get out and find food to eat, and they will nibble on tree bark and grasses and dried plants that are left around. I tell you, they must be really glad when summer, when things start to warm up in the spring. And I bet everybody has seen squirrels around. And, you know, they're pretty famous for gathering seeds, like acorns and other tree seeds and nuts, and burying them. And I see squirrels regularly right on the sidewalk in my neighborhood nibbling on acorns. And they'll bury several hundred acorns, and they have a super sense of smell. And maybe they remember where their acorns are, but they also can smell them. Look how fluffy that tail is. And here is one of the cutest birds. This is a black-capped chickadee. And the black-capped chickadee also stores food for the winter. So in the summertime, the chickadees will eat all kinds of things, even insects. But for the winter, they store away seeds, like in crevices and bark and so forth. Lots and lots of seeds, and they remember where those seeds are. And can you see how round and fat the chickadee's body is? So one of the ways that animals stay warm in the wintertime when it's cold out is they puff up their body covering, whether it's fur or feathers. And that creates a nice insulation of air around their bodies. We're going to talk a little bit more about that in just a second. And this mourning dove was on my windowsill last year in the snow. And you can tell how it's all hunkered down. It's got its head right down against its body, which helps it stay warmer. And one of the cool things about snow is that snow is fluffy and it has lots of air in it. So it also can be an insulation. So although to us, this bird looks really cold, it's probably pretty cozy there in that snow. It probably would like to have a birdseed cookie. And here is the secret to birds staying warm. So birds have a nice outer coating of kind of stiff feathers called contour feathers, and that keeps the wind off of their bodies and acts like a raincoat. And their feathers, this feather is kind of a combination of being an outside feather and an inner downy feather. But this part of the feather, all those little lines, have pieces that zip together and make a nice tight covering over the bird's body. And underneath that, birds have down. And this is a down feather. And instead of having that kind of zipper thing on them, the down feathers are just all loose and all over the place, sort of like messy hair. But that traps air and keeps the birds warm. It makes good insulation. And I wonder, do any of you have a down coat that you wear in the winter time? My coat's down, and in fact, sometimes I find little feathers that have come out around the seams. And so this is an eider duck, and their down is supposed to be the very best. And you can see that this mom is on her nest, and look at all the down feathers she has here. So birds will pull the down from the front of their bodies to use as insulation for their nests and keep their eggs warm. And then also if when the mom has to go off to, you know, maybe get a little bite to eat, she will cover up her eggs to camouflage them. And I wanted to show you very quickly, I have a couple of bird feathers to show you. This is one of those outside feathers. This is a very big one from a wild turkey, which, by the way, is one of the birds that sits around all year. And this is, let's see if I can show that to you. A down, mostly down feather. This is kind of like the one that the picture that was part down and part regular feather. And something else I wanted to show you that I notice on my gloves is there's just little kind of white threads that I notice on my gloves. I think you probably can't see them. But instead of being threads, those are actually another type of down, this just little strip of feather. And I looked at them with a magnifying glass, and sure enough, it's a little tiny feather and not a thread. And one other thing that I wanted to show you, I have some fur.
Wow.
Can anybody guess what animal that we just saw in our pictures and heard about in the book this might be from? So you can call that out or type it in the chat. And Mary, I think you have some things to show us too, don't you?
I do. I think it's so interesting that animals make their own fur coats or down jackets rather than having to put them on. And so as Lynn said, in the fall, the animals start to grow more fur and fat, thicker fur. This is the fur of a beaver. And it's a wonderful coat for that animal because it has two different kinds of hair. It has these longer hairs. They're sort of shiny. They provide sort of like a outside seal that sort of covers the very soft, very fluffy undercoat. And now if you have a dog, you know your dog gets sort of this fluffy undercoat, a heavier fluffy undercoat as fall turns to winter. This fluffy fur is what traps the warm air from the animal's body around its body. And then these other longer hairs also help to keep it in. So together, this fluffy fur and this smooth fur keep a beaver very, very warm. We just have a few more minutes, but I want to show you one more animal and then we're going to get to our seed birdseed cookies. This is an Arctic fox, which also is so, so fluffy. The thing I wanted to mention about this is that the Arctic fox is not this white color all year round. Now, it doesn't live in the area, this area. It does live in the Arctic, but it does change color in the winter to match its surrounding for camouflage. That is another way that animals adapt to the winter. So we're running sort of low on time, so I'm going to take a few minutes now to tell you about how we can help out our animal friends here in New York, who really have a lot less food available to them in the winter than they do in the summer. They really have to work hard to find food, and it takes a lot of energy. So we're going to give them some really healthy food packets, which are seeds. So again, for this project, we'll start with a bowl, and we need to take, we're going to use the unflavored gelatin. Put the unflavored gelatin in the bowl. It's just a packet. It comes just like this. You're going to put it right in. And then you're going to have, pour in a quarter cup of boiling water. This water is in a thermos. I'm holding it there because it is hot. This is a quarter cup little container. So we're going to pour that in. Again, a grown-up's going to help you out with this part because it is boiling hot water. Now what you want to do, you can see this like this. What you're going to do is you're going to stir it, stir, stir, stir for a while until all the lumps are gone. I'm going to give it a good stir. And as you're stirring it, you can kind of feel how the gelatin is starting to thicken, like Jell-O. But again, this is not the flavored sugared Jell-O. It's just plain gelatin. That looks pretty good. I think all, everything is dissolved. Now we're going to take one cup of our birdseed. I'm going to put it in the bowl. This is a one cup scoop. Goes in the bowl. And we're going to stir it all around. As you stir, you're going to see that it's going to start to sort of thicken, which is good because the gelatin is going to hold our seeds together. Now you're going to get your cup or your, if you have a cookie cutter, you want to put the cookie cutter on a plate, and then you're going to spoon the seed and gelatin mixture in to your mold. In this case, it is the cup. You don't want to have it be too fat because you want it to be able to dry. So I would say about that thick, which I would call maybe a half an inch. I'm going to show it to you in the cup here. You're going to press down firmly with your spoon. You could even use your fingers. Press down firmly. And then you're going to take a pencil or maybe a chopstick, just something pointy, and you're going to make a hole. I'm not going to turn it because my hole is going to fall apart, but you're going to make a hole about this size in your cookie. Now what you do is you just set it aside and let it dry and harden. I would give it a day. Now don't put it in the refrigerator. Don't put it in something plastic because that will actually make it mold. You're just going to put it out in the air. If you have a radiator in your house, sitting it right on top of the radiator would be great. But give it a good day to have it dry. And then when it's dry, you're just going to pop it out of the cup or just remove it from the cookie cutter. If it sticks in the cup, just rip the cup right out. It's paper. It should not stick with the cookie cutter. And then you're going to cut. This is about a foot of twine, but cut a length of twine. It doesn't really matter how long. And then you're just going to hang it somewhere outside where the birds can get it. You have a tree or a bush in your yard, you can hang it from there. You can hang it just from your window or just put it on your windowsill or on your door, at your door, at your stoop somewhere. So just somewhere outside where your bird friends in the neighborhood can see it and where they can enjoy it. And you're going to give them a little bit of a treat when during the winter when it's cold and they really could use a little extra food. Again, the seeds are a great food for them. So it really is, it's very helpful for them that you're going to give them some food. Okay.
Well, I want to note that some of our friends out there were right. This is bear fur. And we had a question, do peacocks stay around for the winter? Good question. Peacocks are not native to this area, and there certainly are peacocks around, like in the zoos. And I think they do stay around for the winter. And, you know, I'm not positive. I kind of think peacocks are native to Southeast Asia or maybe Africa. I need to look that up. I'm glad you asked about that. And I'm very quickly going to share my screen again. We have our activity sheet that's going to go along with the grab and go kits. It's got some of the books, some other books about animals in winter, some of the things we talked about today, a QR code to find all of our Hunters Point Environmental Education Center programming, and all the instructions for how to make bird cookies, and a QR code to watch this program again today. And you might be able to download this underneath our YouTube. Please like and share our videos. And we will see you in 1 month on March 1st.
And don't forget that we do have the grab and go kits with all the materials you need to make actually 3 or 4 cookies for the birds in your neighborhood. So have fun making the cookies. I certainly did. And I'm sure your local birds will love you for it. Thanks everyone for joining us. I hope we see you on March 1st. We're going to be talking about March weather.
Thanks a lot.